So, as we look back to our title of the message this morning, it's Upholding the Integrity of Scripture. So, as we look at what integrity means, has anyone ever, like Sam and I, what we do is we butcher our own animals, or we take them to have them to the, take them from the field, we take them to the butcher and have them done. But I've had over the years some butchers that have come back and I'm like, wow, I thought that cow was a lot bigger than that, than this little box that I got back. You know what I mean? You ever had that happen? Or you go to a mechanic and you come back and it's still, now another light's on in your dash. I'm like, what's up with that? I just had it fixed for that. Why? It's this coincidence. I don't know about that. Maybe it is. It just, this integrity thing means a lot. Having integrity means doing the right thing in a reliable way. It doesn't, it's a personality trait that we admire, since it means a person has more a moral compass that doesn't waver. It's always dead set on doing the right thing rather than wavering from that thing. It literally means having noble character, or in clearer terms, not tweaking the truth about what you're doing. So as we look at this upholding the scripture, this is the most important things in our life, if we uphold God's word and not let it waver in any other way, because the truth of scripture is what changes lives, it breaks lives and rearranges them to be in alignment with God's word and to have that life that he's planned for us long ago. A lot of times we get into this mental capacity and we go off to the left or to the right. As I've mentioned many times, we get off on the wrong exit and we are stuck with what we're on that exit, rather than where he has purposed and planned for our lives. So we got to understand that it's either there, that if you don't follow the integrity of scripture, it will lead you astray. And many in, I believe, in churches today are led astray by the person that's not upholding to the word of God. The integrity of scripture, as we'll see this here in a little bit. I would just give you a quick little background. If you remember last time we were going through the book of Acts, we found some of these Jewish leaders that had spoken to these Gentiles that had been saved. And now they're telling them, you know, you need to follow the law of Moses and you need to follow the cross as well. So you got to, where you've been freed, it's like an oxymoron. You've been freed in Christ, but you got to uphold all of these laws. And it doesn't make no sense. That's what they were telling them. This is exactly what Paul and Barnabas had been preaching. They'd been telling them, you don't have to be caught up by the law anymore. There's all of these laws, you don't have to follow them. But once you're in Christ, he has forgiven you from everything, and you're supposed to follow too. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. There's one extra one in there. And to love others as yourself. That's where everything hangs on. And that's what we should be upholding. But now these guys are coming and telling them, no, you need more laws in your life. As we all know what that looks like. But this is exactly what they had been released from, because we couldn't keep the law. You and I still can't keep the law. I can't keep myself from speeding. You know, there's so many different laws. Are laws good? Laws are good. And they keep things in place. But if we look at what the Jewish law was, of 613 oral laws by themselves. There was, you couldn't even, if it was back in the day and they were on in a Sabbath, you couldn't even push the button on an elevator. That was work. So there was some strict guidelines that they were having to follow, and they didn't want to go back to that. So let me give you an example. Let's say you receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, right? And have been set free from all the stuff that had been offensive to God, all the stuff that you had done. But now, I come and tell you, you know, be careful not to go there, or to go there, and you can't ever eat at a place that serves liquor, and you can't wear those type of jeans and those type of earrings. That's legalism. Now you're taking it far. Now you're taking it back into the legalism part of Scripture. You're now putting a burden on people that have been set free. So we got to be very careful of where we look at Scripture and what it tells us about it. You know, I've been a led astray. As Sam and I first got saved, we didn't know any better. We started hearing this preacher tell us about different things and all this stuff. And you know what? I'm so hurt right now because I had to get rid of a lot of stuff in my life. Sam did too. her poor Prince album got thrown away. You know, my Johnny Cash, all my little CDs got thrown away because it was bad if I listened to anything like that. And I thought, I fell into the burning ring of fire. Maybe that's what it was that threw everybody off. You know what I mean? You guys didn't get that. The old people got that. But what happens is we lead these people into places that they shouldn't be. You know, people look and say, well, I'm not going to have a Cocopelli in my house because it's evil. It's only if you give it power does it have anything over you. Christ is the one that reigns in us. Nobody has power over us. Only Christ himself. You know, as we live in this world, you and I have to make our own choices how we choose to live in this world and yet not be partakers of the things of it. There's things all around we could indulge ourselves in, but we know it's wrong. And our moral compass should be set on what's right and what Scripture upholds. We can live a part of it, but we got to be careful not to take care of its delicacies. It has a lot of stuff that's attracting to us, but in that attraction, it leads us to somewhere we shouldn't be. It's temporal. Those things that attract us are temporal, and they give us short happiness, and don't give us a lasting happiness as Christ does. As any of you have been there, you know what that is. You know, in our men's group on Friday mornings, we're going through the book of Judges. And in the book of Judges, the Lord left the Canaanites in the land of Israel. And they had to live amongst them. And the Canaanites were worshiping their own gods and doing their own thing, the Asherah poles and all this other stuff that they were worshiping. Yet God's people were there as a test, said, can you live amongst them and not go over there and deal with them? That's your test to see if you can live like that. You know, we see this even in our own lives today. Of we're supposed to live in it, but not take parts of it. We're supposed to be the light, the salt and the light of it. How are we giving the taste to other people that know that we're believers? What taste are we leaving in their mouths of saying, I shouldn't even be a believer because you act like everybody else? We're supposed to be different. We're supposed to be set apart for God's purposes. And that's where we go back to looking at what Scripture tells us about the Word. But ultimately, the ball is on our court on how we will follow Christ. It's up to us. We have that free choice. He never forces us to do anything. That's love, though. You can't force love on anybody. Say, you need to love me. That would be fake. He wants us to love him because of who he is. So if we pick up today, as we look at verse 22, and that's what we'll be picking up. The decision was made to send some men back to the people who were flustered by the message of the men of Judea. These men that had come and told them that you should follow the law. And they're coming back with this letter because they had sent them to the Jewish leaders and the elders to go say, what do you say about this? So they went up there. Now they're on their way back. So let's look. We'll pick up in verse 22. I'm going to stop there for a second. I'm going to pray. Father, before I start this morning, Lord, I just ask that you prepare my heart, prepare my family's heart this morning, that we would be set apart for you. Our mind would be focused on you this morning and nothing else. Father, I just ask that we would adhere to your word this morning and your words of integrity would be upon our minds and our hearts this morning. We thank you so much in Jesus' name. Verse 22. Then it seemed good to the apostles and the elders and to the whole church to choose men from among them and send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. They sent Judas, called Barsabbas, and Silas, leading men among the brothers, with the following letter. The brothers, both the apostles and the elders, to the brothers who are of the Gentiles in Antioch and Syria and Cilicia, greetings. Since we have heard that some persons have gone out from us and trouble you with words, unsettling your minds, although we gave them no instructions. So right away, we get to see that some men were chosen to go and talk with them. But here we get to see that These people, they were telling them that they had to follow other laws, were from among them. They were the same, what would be called Christians. And they're telling them, hey, you need to do this, you need to do that. Although they didn't give them no instructions. How many times do we see that in our world today? It might be from among the church, and they're going and spreading out a different gospel than what Christ has preached. And we're supposed to be noteworthy of what's being said. The way we know that is, I'll note this in a second, is to be Bereans. When you're in the Word of God, you know when you come across something false. You catch it right away because you know the Word of the truth. And when something passes, we all know. When we're something, somebody's trying to jibe us, somebody's trying to mess with us, we know it. And that's what it is with the Word of truth. We know when somebody's telling us not truth. In our cities, there are people of the faith that come up with their own conclusions, with their own crazy faiths, and you need to do this. And as I mentioned many times, the shaking of snakes and doing all this stuff and flopping on the floor and all this other weird stuff that I have never seen in Scripture. Or maybe they've taken out of the context of Scripture and using it to build upon their own foundations. And that's not truth. There's got to be context within Scripture. If not, it's a proof text. I'll prove to anything. But read before, after. That's just a little thought for you. As I said, be a Berean. Search the Scriptures for ourselves or for yourselves and don't take anyone's word for it. Not even mine. You search the Scriptures to know that I say what I'm saying is true. You and I, as believers, must uphold the truth and its integrity. Even if correction needs to happen, let it be done so in love. Because I've come across different things that people have told me. I've even caught correction. But I need to look at it and say, okay, how am I going to handle this? Am I going to rebuke them, or how am I going to say, you're wrong? Or that just caused conflict. You can come and say, well, let's look at it together. Let's look at what Scripture really means. And we get through the passage that way. Verse 25. It seemed good to us, they continue on with this letter, having come to one accord in this, together in one mind, to choose men and send them to you with beloved Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So these guys got together and they chose these men to go along with Paul and Barnabas. And I had to think about this week. If there was an important mission for our church today, would you be selected for that, to go out and minister? Would we be entrusted with leading others? As I said, I had to ask myself this. Am I faithful enough to be selected to go out and preach His Word? To go out with others to go and be preaching His Word? And that's what we have to look at. Because we can look and say, well, who would they have chosen? Would they have been choosing the guy that doesn't read his Bible? Or that doesn't serve? Or doesn't come and associate? He comes once in a while, hit and miss. Do you think that's the person they're selecting? Or it's someone that's embedded in the Word of God that loves Jesus Christ, is on fire? We get to see who they're looking at and who they're choosing. Judas and Silas were put here as notable leaders of the Church of Jesus Christ and were sent out on this mission with Barnabas and Paul to be able to go help them in the work of the ministry. As we know, we are being prepared, equipped to go out and do the same thing, to go out and be equipped for the work of the ministry. You know, here at Inspire, how we choose leaders, it's because they're leading. A lot of times we get them into ministry, but if they take over that ministry and they start to lead, and you know, they're already natural leaders, they want to serve Christ in that capacity, they're automatically put into that position. Because they're a wannabe leading. They're not just hanging out. As I was mentioning to the men at our breakfast yesterday, there's three types of these Christian type of people. Some that sit on the sidelines. Oh, you need to, let's say a ball game. They sit in the sidelines and they say, oh, you need to do that, and you need to do that, and you need to do that, but never get off the bench. Then you have the referee guy. the referee Christian. Oh, you did this wrong, and you did that wrong, and did this wrong, and he's making all the calls. Or you can be the player where you can huddle everybody together and give them direction how to go. Where are you going to be? Will you be sitting on the sidelines, or are you going to be the referee, or are you going to get in the game and start working? That's what we need to focus on. Will we get in the game? Verse 27. We therefore sent Judas and Silas, who themselves will tell you the same things by word of mouth. For it has seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay on you no greater burden than these requirements, that you abstain from what has been sacrificed to idols, and from blood, and from what has been strangled, and from sexual immorality. If you keep yourselves from these, you will do well. And it also says farewell. It mentions here in this letter the word of by word of mouth, meaning they came with this letter face to face. So how many of you guys in social media, email, text, have got a misinterpretation from someone or sent someone and they think it's something else? Especially texts, they're like, oh, they're all mad and they're this and they're that, and emails are this. You can't really know what's happening or what's being said. These guys were being sent face to face. If there was anything that was going to happen, they could answer questions. And that's the way we should be communicating also within the church. It's nice to text back and forth, but if it gets to a place where I don't understand, hey, let's call. Or if it's, have you ever got them those text pages? You keep on going and scrolling and scrolling. It's like, God, how long did it take you to write that on the little thing? But it's that we can call them. There's also a number you can call, just informing you. If you can call them and talk to them, and I bet you, you get a better understanding of what's being said than you get from that text. When you stand face to face with someone and tell them. You know, it also mentions here in verse 28 that they were led by the Spirit. You know, it's being led by the Spirit is the best thing we can do. It's the ultimate guide in our lives. It goes before us. It leads the way. It removes our obstructions. And it opens our understandings. And making all things plain and clear. When we're led by the Spirit and not by our flesh, we make decisions upon the Spirit, not upon our flesh. And it's hard to do so. Are you guys with me? How hard is it to react in the Spirit than it is in the flesh? I want to rear up. The old man wants to come up. The guy that got baptized, he's still got a noose on my leg trying to pull me back in the water. It's just that old nature that we fight against every single day. That's what he says. We must die to ourselves and pick up our cross daily and follow him. That's that, is dying to ourselves in the way we want to react. Because I can get hot-headed. I'm sure some of you, oh no, you guys don't. You guys are good. In Romans 8:14, it says this, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God." That's where we need to be, is led by the Spirit. We're also called His children. Do we have trouble with that? I have trouble with it. I'm still working on it. I thank Him for His grace and mercy in my life. It's still working with me, and I'm getting better. Verse 29. You know, last time we talked about this, I mentioned why they had given these decrees to stay away from these sacrificed idols and sexual immorality and all these different pieces. And say, well, why are they putting the law back on them? It wasn't that they were putting the law back on them. We got the Jewish people now, and we got these Gentiles. Each one had their own way of doing things. And now they just had, it was a learning curve for both of them, saying, if you're doing this, you're creating a stumbling block for them now. So there's that change that needs to happen within the Jewish people, within the Gentiles, to live together in Christ. In other words, they had stuff to work on, as you and I. I still have a bunch of stuff to work on that I'm working on daily in my life, that the Lord is cleaning up. He's always in the corner saying, man, you make a mess. I need to get this little... Does anybody know what a palito is? Isn't that what it's called? The little dustpan. I was brought up saying it was a palito. He does that a lot with me, so I know you guys are laughing because he does it with you too. But you know what? As we work on our things, you and I can't go back to living the way we used to live, correct? Without getting some type of different results. If not, we're going to continue to do that insanity thing, doing the same things over and over and say, why my life hasn't changed? Because we're living the same way we used to live. We need that human responsibility to be able to make that happen, taking the first step and say, Lord, use me, move me, clean me. We need to take that first step for Him to start working on it. It's in Scripture. We need to first take that step of faith and say, Lord, work in me. And He will. Because as I've mentioned before, repentance shows a different way of living. You weren't the same as you were once were. When someone comes in contact with you, what happened to you? You're not like that anymore. But to God be the glory, because that's the opportunity to tell them what happened in your life. I was once blind and now I can see. Verse 30. So when they were sent off, they went down to Antioch, and having gathered the congregation together, they delivered this letter. So they read this letter aloud to them. Verse 31, and when they had read it, they rejoiced because of its encouragement. And Judas and Silas, who were themselves prophets, encouraged and strengthened the brothers with many words. And after they had spent some time there, they were sent off in peace by the brothers to those who had sent them. But Paul and Barnabas remained in Antioch, teaching and preaching the word of the Lord with many others also. And when they had read it, it says in verse 31, they rejoiced because of its encouragement. What was being read in that letter that brought him so much encouragement? That once again they were free. That they weren't still in bondage. They were free. This letter commanded that. It commended them to say, you're still free. We get to see that. Did you know that you and I can have that same encouragement today? That same letter read to us today? You can open the Word of God and still receive encouragement from His love letter to us. That's His love letter of saying, how much grace and mercy, the more I open that book, the more I understand how much His grace and mercy is towards me. Not willing that any of us would perish or die, but that we would all come to repentance, that change of life. And that's what He wants for us. In verse 32, as Judas and Silas were doing here, they were sent there to encourage and strengthen others. What does that look like to strengthen and to encourage others? What does that look like? It means we have to die to ourselves once again and put our agendas aside and help others that are struggling in their walks. To come alongside one. In Galatians 2, 1 and 2, it says, dear brothers and sisters, if another believer is overcome by some sin, you who are godly should gently and humbly help that person back into the right path. And it says, be careful not to fall into the same temptation yourself. Share each other's burdens, it says, and in this way obey the law of Christ. So when we're stuck in these situations where I'm this and I'm that and I'm in a deep dark place, you need to reach out to those brothers around you to help you out. You know, when I was growing up, I was so afraid. You know, there was a lot of different things I was afraid of, and I laugh at them now. You guys remember the Slee Stacks? Back in, what was that, the Land of the Lost? I was terrified of them. And I seen them recently, and I'm like, I was afraid of that? One other thing I was afraid of was quicksand. Didn't be afraid of quicksand when they were kids? So you're going to fall into quicksand. You know, and I just think of these things of how if I was in quicksand, would I just let myself go under? Would I be crying out for help, saying, I'm going under, I need help? How many of us would have that much pride to say, hey, I'm just going to go down? You're not a, what do they call those, a captain of the ship. You don't have to go down with a ship. You can ask for help. We all have stuff. We all have different things in our lives that we're dealing with. But it's coming out of those places and wanting to get rid of those things. It sheds some light of Christ into those things that we can be once again revived from those things that once easily ensnared us. So, it says that Judas and Silas spent more time there and then they were sent off. So, I don't know who's reading an ESV this morning, or maybe some of your other translations. What happened to verse 34? But something happened. It jumped from 32 to 35, and I was like, wow, there's a big old typo in there. Some of the other versions have that. They have verse 34. Because in the original manuscripts, there's a lot of debate on this piece of scripture here because of what happened. Some of the other pieces are put back in there. Verse 34 is put in there that they ended up staying. And they actually did. But just so when you know, when you see that, I'll say, what happened here? And if you have questions after that, I can explain that. But I'm not going to go there today. Just so if you guys come across that, there was some debate on that. So let's jump into verse 36. After some days, Paul said to Barnabas, "Let us return and visit the brothers in every city where we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are." Paul cared what was happening to these people. He just didn't leave them there to their own devices. Because I remember when I got saved, I really didn't know how to work it out. I remember getting saved, and this is your pastor talking. I remember getting saved, and it was late fall. But I already had a New Year's Eve party planned. I wasn't going to cancel that. But I still was still void of the truth. Somebody still hadn't come beside me and started walking me along and saying, that's going to ensnare you again if you don't watch out. And just coming alongside and say, be careful with that. I'm not telling them to follow these laws. I'm just telling them, be careful, because if you go back over there, you're probably going to get caught back in that web of where you used to be. David Jeremiah, in his commentary, says this: "It was not Paul's heart to win people to Christ and then allow them to struggle their own way on their own. He was a spiritual obstetrician as well as a pediatrician. He wanted to return and make sure the new believers that he left behind were growing in the Lord and being built up in their faith." If we look at, he was a spiritual obstetrician and a pediatrician. He was helping them as they came out and were born again into this new spirit. And now he's checking them as a pediatrician. Once the child is born, that's one thing. But then you need follow-ups, right? To be a you take them to the pediatrician. And that's what Paul and Barnabas are doing. They're coming back and checking to say, are you growing? Is there something going on? Are you coming along? How can I help you? This should be the concern for all of us this morning, of how many times we're coming along those others and doing the same thing, is strengthening them, encouraging them, visiting them regarding their growth. Is it look like Christ likeness? You know, too often in our modern day church, we concern ourselves with the physical condition of somebody. Are you okay? You're in the hospital. You're sick. You're this and that, rather than knowing what their spiritual condition is, which is more important. We need to know where a person's heart is. As I go many times into the hospital to pray for different people, I want to know, in fact, that if things can turn in hospitals, as I know you know, I would rather know that their spiritual condition is in shape rather than their physical, because I know where they will pass into eternity too. That's what's most important to me, is knowing that they're dead set where they're going. Verse 37. Now Barnabas wanted to take, so you get to see here, we get to see a dispute in Scripture, and I love that the Scripture's clear about every piece of Scripture. So, verse 37, now Barnabas wanted to take with him called Mark. But Paul thought best not to take him with one of them, who had withdrawn from them, and Pamphylia had not gone with him to do the work. So we get to see early on in Acts, Barnabas was John Mark's cousin, and he wanted him to be along with him on this journey. But Paul had other reasons for not wanting him to tag along. He said he left us hanging at one point before, and I don't know that I want him to go. So there was a dispute here, it says. Verse 39 tells us this. It says, and there arose a sharp disagreement. These guys have been doing ministry together for years and brought many people to Christ, but yet here's something that happened. So they separated from each other, it said. Barnabas took Mark with him, and they sailed away to Cyprus. But Paul chose Silas and departed, having been commended by the brothers to the grace of the Lord. And he went through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. To their credit, even though they had conflict, even though it was a sharp disagreement, it didn't stop them from wanting to continue on. They didn't let this conflict distract them from where the Lord was moving them. A lot of times we get into conflicts in our lives, other churches, different things in our lives, and we let that derail us from doing the work of the ministry. And Satan has got you just where he wants you. To stop doing the work of the ministry, stop preaching the gospel because you're upset about something. So neither of them let this stop them from their efforts of spreading the gospel. You know, if we look at this, there wasn't a disagreement of doctrine. It was just a personal disagreement that they had about someone. Here we see a glance of Barnabas' patience with the failures of others. Early on in Acts chapter 4, Barnabas was called the son of encouragement. And now he's wanting to give John Mark this other chance to make it right. And Paul didn't want to have nothing to do with it. We don't know why. It doesn't say why this happened. But this friendship had been gone back 15 years between the two of them, and neither would yield. Yet they went their own ways. So let me ask you this. Which one was right? Paul or Barnabas? Does it matter? It doesn't matter. Because they were both sent out to do the work of the ministry. They always continued on doing that work. And that's what matters. You know, what I love about the Bible is it shares with us and it shows us sometimes great saints have issues, like you and I. That's what gives me hope, is that they had issues, as I do. Whether Barnabas or Paul, King David, the Apostle Peter, when we see their biographies of their lives, of these saints, they're valuable because they show us the weakness of our heroes as well as their strengths. We can be thankful that the Bible is honest in its portrayal. Even the best saints have some problems sometimes. And that just gives me hope that sometimes I stumble and fall and I get back up and I'm saying, okay. Rather than sitting in the pool of despair where I can be when things go wrong, I can stay there and pity pool around, or I can get out of it and say, I'm moving forward for the sake of Christ. I finish this morning, and I'm going to leave you with this piece of scripture out of 1 Corinthians 1, 26 through 31. It says this, brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were noble of birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness and holiness in our redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. And that's where we should be. That's the only thing we have to boast about. Regardless of what life throws at us, regardless of what we've been through, we can boast only about what Christ has done in our lives. That's the only thing that laughs. That's the only thing that's gonna you're going to be able to hang your hat on is Christ and Christ alone. So just remember this morning, when we walk in integrity, walk upholding the truth of Scripture. You know how it is to be cheated. So we need to be clear in the understanding when we give someone the word that it's clear in its understanding and its truth. Amen. Nobody loves me like you love me.